Hey there, Internewebs, and welcome back to How Fascinating, where this week we'll be culminating March of the Megafauna with some of the largest animals ever to walk the Earth. That is, assuming they actually existed. Pop quiz. Which of the following was never a dinosaur? A. Triceratops, B. Brontosaurus, or C. Dimetrodon? The clever cookies, cool kids, and all armchair paleontologists in the audience probably already know that C, the Dimetrodon, is not and never was a dinosaur. It was a synapsid, the same type of animal as mammals and mammal-like reptiles. True dinosaurs belong to the clade Sauropsidae, which includes all modern-day birds and reptiles. But hang on, I pretend to hear you cry. What about the Brontosaurus? I thought the Brontosaurus was really just an apatosaurus or something. Well, you see, the official scientific verdict on the Brontosaurus was, for many years, but currently, science says yes, the Brontosaurus is its own genus. The short version of the story is that both the Apatosaurus and the Brontosaurus were first discovered in the western United States in the late 1870s, but due to similarities in the fossilized remains and the lack of evidence otherwise, the type species Brontosaurus excelsus was declared in 1903 to merely be a species of the Apatosaurus genus. That remained the official scientific position on the matter for the remainder of the 20th century, but recent research found sufficiently numerous differences and further consideration led to the 2015 decision to reclassify the Brontosaurus and Apatosaurus as separate genera. Brontosaurus is back, baby. Or perhaps I should say, Brontosaurus is back, maybe. Celebrated paleontologist Donald Prothero has criticized the recent study and ensuing media reaction, saying, quote, "Until someone has convincingly addressed the issue, I'm going to put Brontosaurus in quotes and not follow the latest media fad, nor will I overrule Riggs and put the name in my books as a valid genus," unquote. He's not alone in his defiance either, and the official scientific position will likely continue to be for the foreseeable future. Whether or not you'll use the name, Brontosaurus comes from the Greek for thunder lizard, so-called because it was absolutely enormous, but this name turned out to be incredibly apt. Computer simulations conducted in 1997 by a Microsoft scientist showed that sauropods like the Brontosaurus may have been capable of swinging their tails like whips, breaking the sound barrier and creating a sonic boom as loud as a cannon, over 200 decibels. Link to the article in the description. Because Brontosaurus means thunder lizard and Apatosaurus means deceitful lizard, I like to imagine the pair have a sort of Thor and Loki relationship, but that's just me. Maybe Tyr can take the form of a T-Rex. Heh, that was awful. Sauropods aren't the only dinosaurs with weaponized tails either. This is the Stegosaurus, and this is its Thagomizer. If that name sounds like a joke, that's because it is, but it's still the de facto technical term. It comes from the 1982 Farside comic and was originally meant as a lighthearted joke, but because no official term existed for the stegosaurid tail spikes prior to that point, the scientific community just sort of went with it. The term was first adopted by paleontologist Ken Carpenter of the Denver Museum of Nature and Science at the 1993 meeting of the Society of Vertebrate Paleontology, and it's since been used by the BBC series Planet Dinosaur, Dinosaur National Monument, and even the Smithsonian. You're welcome and indeed invited to laugh at those spikes, but there's another spiky dinosaur whose story is no less silly, but not intentionally so. The genus Iguanodon was first named in 1825, and only relatively recently, in the nearly 200 years since then, have we had any good idea what the damn thing really looked like. It's famous for its thumb spikes, but early reconstructions by Gideon Mantell placed it on the nose like a rhino horn, and it stayed there for almost 60 years until Louis Dolo reconstructed them in 1882. The Crystal Palace Park dinosaurs were the first life-size reconstructions of extinct animals ever made, commissioned in 1852, and they show Iguanodon as a squat, scaly, iguana-like quadruped with the spike incorrectly located on the nose. The 1878 Bernassar find, which led to the spikes being relocated to the thumbs, though, also led to the discovery that Iguanodons had shorter forelimbs and their subsequent reimagining as bipeds channeling the fawns. Actually, these reconstructions were closer to tripeds, as they showed the tails being used as a third point of stability. The problem with this is that it required the tails to be literally broken. David Norman's 1985 research a century later showed that their tails were long, with ossified tendons leading them to be relatively stiff. So we're back to quadrupeds, but not quite. Although their forelimbs have aspects of weight-bearing structures, it seems most likely that iguanodons achieved maximum speed when running bipedally and used the forelimbs for support at other times. This is what biologists refer to as facultative bipedalism, and it can be seen in modern pangolins who look like they just washed their hands and are searching for a towel. Do you remember how at the start of this video I gave you the chance to say that the Triceratops wasn't a dinosaur? Well, you wouldn't have been wrong to pick that option either. Maybe. Arguably. Get ready for Brontosaurus Part 2. The Triceratops is like that, only more so. You see, with the Brontosaurus and Apatosaurus genera, the former was or is considered a subset of the latter, depending on whom you ask, but the Triceratops is now currently believed by some to have been an immature form of the related Torosaurus. No one's arguing they never existed, because they clearly did, saying that would be like saying teenagers don't exist, but calling Triceratops its own separate genus may be like saying teenagers are a different species from humans, which is false, even though they certainly act that way at times. The theory that the Torosaurus is just an aged-up Triceratops was first proposed only relatively recently in 2009 by John Scanella in a paper presented at the conference of the Society of Vertebrate Paleontology. Yes, them again. Obviously, this sparked a fair amount of debate, much of which continues to this day. Despite arguing just 3 years prior that no systemic differences besides the characteristic frill could be found between the two genera, fellow paleontologist Andrew Fark argued that the morphological changes that would have to occur to turn a Triceratops into a Torosaurus would be completely unprecedented in ceratopsids. Bone structure would have to revert from mature to immature and then back to mature again, and a 2012 study by Field and Longrich found Triceratops individuals too old to be considered immature as well as Torosaurus individuals too young. Until further transitional fossils are discovered, the synonymy of Triceratops and Torosaurus will remain in question. The jury is likely to still be out for a while then, but you can rest easy for the moment. Even if the Triceratops is determined to be nothing more than a juvenile Torosaurus, it can still keep the name. The first Triceratops fossils were discovered before the Torosaurus, and when this sort of thing happens, scientists just keep whichever name came first. Next question. What's the name of this dinosaur? Ignoring the fact that it's an inaccurate recreation from a work of fiction, obviously. You, presumably, said T-Rex. Correct, good job, have a biscuit. Here's the thing, though. Tyrannosaurus rex literally means Tyrant Lizard King. In addition to looking nothing like Jim Morrison, this feature creature, like all the dinosaurs in Jurassic Park, is explicitly stated to be dual-wielding X chromosomes. Therefore, you could argue she should be called Tyrannosaurus Regina, or Tyrant Lizard Queen. There's your strong female character, you screaming internet harpies. I have one other thing to say about this charming lady, and it's that she's projecting an unrealistic body image for other dinosaurs to live up to. In case you didn't know, the T-Rex never looked like this. We suspect it probably looked more like this, but the giant lizard looks cooler. Normally I'd complain about this sort of thing, but Jurassic Park is a movie to entertain the public, and its eponymous location is a theme park also made to entertain the public. Genetic engineers had to reconstruct T-Rex from scratch, so it's understandable that they'd spice things up a little. Also, they filled in the gaps with frog DNA for some reason. Probably would have been better off going with some kind of bird, but what do I know? It's not like I made an entire video to complain about the conflation of reptiles and amphibians. Oh, wait. Speaking of, a lot of people are really butthurt by the idea that T-Rex had feathers, like being a giant bird somehow makes it less terrifying, but can I just remind you all of the twice-divorced velociraptor that is the cassowary? As my girlfriend pointed out, most people will also go running if pursued by a single goose, to say nothing of swans, and I can tell you from bitter personal experience that the only way to deal with an aggressive goose is to throw up your dukes and walk towards it with the confidence of someone who's not afraid to go back to jail. Speaking of birds, what's this? Jurassic Park says it's a velociraptor, but real-life velociraptors were only the size of a modern-day turkey. Utah raptors are estimated to have been a bit over 2 meters tall, and other dromaeosaurids like Deinonychus, upon which JP's velociraptors are based, fall somewhere in between the two. The whole family is often referred to by the informal name of raptors due to its two famous members, but raptor traditionally refers to birds of prey, such as eagles, hawks, and vultures, and we must never forget about kestrels. The name comes from the Latin rapere, meaning seize, and as it turns out, all birds are raptors since they belong to the clade Maniraptora. Since dinosaurs are birds, i.e. theropods, dromaeosaurids would technically be raptors, in a way. Now, can you name this dinosaur? I can, and I choose to name her Cinnamon. You probably said Ankylosaurus, and if so, good job, have another biscuit. I actually don't have much to say about Cinnamon here, but this is a video about dinosaurs, so I've gotta work in most of their greatest hits. You know, T-Rex, Triceratops, Stegosaurus, Iguanodon, Sauropods, Ankylosaurus, Raptors, and a token, not actually a dinosaur, Dimetrodon. Obviously, I'm missing some big hitters like pterosaurs, hadrosaurs, plesiosaurs, pachycephalosaurs, and Archaeopteryx, but I only have so much time in a single video, and people just like so many dinosaurs. Why are we so fascinated by dinosaurs, though? I have a pet theory about that, but I wish I had a pet dinosaur because that'd be cooler. To tell the truth, humans have had a fascination with dragons and monsters well before we even knew dinosaurs ever existed, so digging them up in the early 1800s was like discovering your fantasy was actually reality. Prehistory, but reality nonetheless. Maybe that's why early reconstructions of dinosaurs looked so reptilian, draconic, and monstrous. We were just working with the limited remains we found and filling in the rest with the images we already had. When dinosaur fossils were first discovered in China, they were assumed to be the bones of dragons who had ascended to their final form. The Mandarin word for dinosaur, even today, is konglong, meaning fearsome dragon. I'm not going to judge, though. The English word comes from the Greek for terrible lizard, so potato-potato, really. We've also got kaiju, who are essentially dragons for the atomic age and post-nuclear era, and the granddaddy of all kaiju and king of the monsters himself, Godzilla, got his iconic look from a combination of the T-Rex, Iguanodon, and Stegosaurus. So while it may be true that dinosaurs are all long gone today, if they even existed in the first place, dragons are here to stay, and their real-life forerunners will live on through them. That concludes March of the Megafauna, so thanks for watching, and have a fascinating day.